All right. Again, so thankful to be here. And as we continue in our study of the Old Testament and of specifically this period of time in the divided kingdom, we're getting closer and closer to the end here. In our last study, we completed looking at Ahaz and the wickedness that he had done in Judah. Now, at the end... end of today's class, we're getting into Hezekiah, his son, which will be really the opposite of Ahaz. But last week, we kind of set up a stark contrast between these two men. And so we looked at Ahaz. We also began to look at Hoshea. Now, there's not a lot written about Hoshea, but Hoshea is important in that he's the last king in Israel. He is king. It's in his ninth year that Israel falls under the hand of Assyria as God uses them to take captive the Israelite people. We'll finish that up this evening. We'll see that after they're taken captive and removed from the land, Assyria then will resettle Samaria. And we'll spend just a minute on that because it's real important. Because even as you get into the New Testament, it would be helpful to know what happens in Israel, in Samaria. That'll help explain some of what you see in the New Testament. And so we'll look at that. I got those backwards, but the fall of Israel and then Assyria resettles Samaria. Hezekiah, then we'll get into looking at Hezekiah. Hezekiah's reign is very important, and we'll see why. A lot of it has to do with his reforms and his desire to come back to God. And so, again, he stands in that stark contrast to his father. And then you got another contrast, stark one with Manasseh. And we'll endeavor to try to get to him today. It's a lot of material, though. But let's go back to 2 Kings 17. That's where we left off last week. We're looking at Hoshea. Hoshea, of course, here... he is the last king of the northern kingdom of Israel. It's at this point. It'd be good if I had that on the right map. But you'll have the Assyrians will come down into the northern kingdom. They will invade. They will attempt to get into Judah. They will actually come into Judah, but then God will send them away. But they are invading. They will take Samaria, which will end the period of the divided kingdom. And I think one thing that's kind of neat is, we'll look at it. Hezekiah tries to bring everybody back together, and we'll see how he does that. I think it's kind of interesting. How he attempts to bring back the Israelite people who remain in Israel back into the fold. And some do. So 2 Kings 17, and we won't read this whole text, but just want to look at it. So we note the first part of the chapter discusses who Hoshea is. He's not a good king. He continues in that same kind of line of kings who've made very poor choices. And so in verse 6, in the ninth year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria captured Samaria. Now what we do note is the preceding verses is that this wasn't overnight. The text tells us it took about 3 years of raids into Israel or Samaria, the northern kingdom, before they finally took the capital of Israel, which is Samaria. Again, the Bible will use those kind of interchangeable. Sometimes it'll call Israel Samaria. And it's interesting, when you get into the New Testament, John chapter 4, and I'll give you a quick example of this. John chapter 4, what is the woman known as in John chapter 4 that Jesus meets at Jacob's well? How do we all know her? What? The Samaritan woman. Now, where did she live, though? Did she live in Samaria? No. She lived in Shikar, which was to the east, if I'm right, east of Samaria, kind of northeast of Samaria. And so, even, as you get to the New Testament, you will see that reference. And we're going to kind of see why, what happens in the resettlement process. So, as you continue reading 6 through 12, again, I'll just summarize this. He is, he's just summarizing what's happened in Israel. So, real quickly, what's happened in Israel since the divided kingdom came about? What have we seen the northern kingdom do? What was their first mistake?
Disobedience.
Yeah, it's all kind of a disobedience of God. But like specifically, what were they doing to disobey God? Okay, so one of the first things we see them do is the intermarrying. But even before that, what was one of the very first things that Jeroboam did? Yes. Now, they had already been exposed for a long time to idolatry, and it didn't creep into the land. You remember even back with Solomon and all his foreign wives, what did they bring in? Well, they brought in their foreign gods. So idolatry had been a problem, but when Jeroboam came along, he actually made two golden calves. You remember what two cities he set them up in? Raise your hand if you know. Oh, go ahead. Dan. Bethel, right? One at the northern part of the kingdom and one at the southern part of the kingdom, pretty close to Jerusalem. I don't think that's without reason for him. So they really dove headlong into idolatry, and it continued to be a problem throughout. Now, there were men who came along who tried to reform and make some reforms to the kingdom. Jehu being one of those. Jehu was the one that tried to expel Baal worship. But they struggled with this. They struggled with intermarriage. That was a big problem. And that's going to become a characteristic of the Samaritan people going forward as we move into the future. So what else did we see them struggle with? Yes. They even changed the calendar, the Israelite calendar, and added things into it, moved things. He also changed the priesthood. You remember the priesthood was a big deal. He said, we'll accept anybody but the Levites. I don't care what tribe you come from. You're a tribe of Simeon? Okay, great. Come on. You want to be a priest? We'll make you a priest. We also saw them, they altered the temple, they built temples to other gods, they set up idols to other gods, they created the high places, they even at one point were burning their children to foreign gods. Now, you see a mirror of that in the south. This is not to say that Jerusalem was much better. What Jerusalem had that Israel just never had was a legitimate reformer. They're just never, other than the attempt somewhat by Jehu, there was just no other kings in the north that really made any real reformations. And so he in 2 Kings 17, 6 through 12 is just summarizing kind of their history. Verse 11 tells us that what they did provoked the Lord to anger. So what is he doing in those six verses, or seven verses? If you think about this from a trial standpoint, and it's as though Israel, Samaria, is on trial. What is he doing as the prosecutor here? Presenting the charges and giving his closing argument, isn't he? This is why God is sending you into captivity. This is why he's allowing this to happen. And you'll note even in there, he he says God attempted to send prophets to you, but you refused to hear. You refused to listen. And yet you chose the wicked nations over God. Yeah, let's think about
it. We're in the same shape when it comes to sin, right? He tries to work with us. He tries to tell us. And we have a choice. Am I going to listen or not?
Well, let's extrapolate that just for a second. What are the ways God sends prophets or his word more directly into our life to get us to wake up? What are the different ways he tries to do that? How does God try to reach us today? Okay, so whatever the church does through its preaching, through its Bible classes, through its written materials.
And us encouraging one another.
Okay, through its ambassadors, Christians, we in each other's lives are to spread the word. Let's go back to the source, though. At the source of all of it is where? The Bible, right? The Word of God is God's number one tool in reformation in the Christian life, right? That's his number one call to repentance for us, right? It's calling out to us, repent, come back, turn. And then through these other avenues, through preaching and teaching, through written literature, through the interaction of brothers and sisters coming together, any other calls to that God uses in a providential way? What?
Your personal reading or study when the Spirit convicts you about a passage. You have that option to listen to the convicting thoughts in your mind or to blow it off and say, I'm going to listen to that.
Our own confronting with the text, right? When we sit down with it and it confronts us, right?
God acts directly at some level. So, I mean, we pray for people and, I believe in his providence or his intervention, however he chooses. I mean, that can be an experience. It could be absolutely anything that he chooses to use. Somebody at work, somebody on the street. Life-changing experience that causes us to think about things differently.
Here's one. I'll say it after this.
These life-changing experiences, sometimes it allows us to have answered prayers. We pray for patience. Well, how are you going to get that? It's not just going to be delivered in a package. You've got to go through trials. And those trials are hard. Yeah.
And so there's another one. Just going through a trial can make us to face something, can it?
Yeah.
Go through a hard time. Doesn't that kind of sometimes wake us up? I hope. Sometimes I think it's God trying to wake us up. Trials are a way God sometimes. And think about when God's word isn't penetrating, when his preaching and teaching isn't penetrating, when his ambassadors are not able to penetrate your heart, when his literature or his other avenues to get it out there aren't working for you. Sometimes, will God use a circumstance to get us?
Yes, sir. I know the one that got me was 9/11. That opened my eyes.
And things like that can wake us up, either an external one or a personal one.
Yes.
And so as Christians, we need to be aware of that, right? We need to be listening for those things. I think what can be difficult for us as human beings is to become unteachable. And I think it's very easy to get into that place where the Word of God just simply cannot penetrate our heart. Think about King Saul. Had he gotten to a place in his life when it was just unteachable? Who did it to him?
Himself,
right? God didn't do it to him. Other people in his life didn't do it to him. And sometimes we'll blame other people. Sometimes we may even be so audacious to blame God. It's not God's fault. It's not other people's fault. Now, people may do bad things to me. But the only way we can be separated from God is how?
We walk away.
Us walking away. Nothing can separate us from the love of God, right? And then what Paul says, I think 1 Corinthians or Romans. Oh, I have to look that up. Sorry. Thought I had that scripture reference in my head. But there's nothing can separate us from the love of God. Not principalities, not powers. Somebody look that up for me. Give me. This is Romans 8. So, yes, ma'am, go ahead.
That reminds me of scripture, and I don't know exactly where it is, where they had a heart of unbelief, when they didn't want to go into, when the 12 spies were sent out, and they didn't go into the promised land because they had a heart of, God told them, listen, I'm giving you this land. And once they went to check it out, they saw all of these giants. So, yeah, somewhere in Hebrews talked about a heart of unbelief. And in Hebrew, the Holy Spirit, through whoever wrote Hebrew, warns us of that.
Mm-hmm. Well, and let's look in our text here, and we just pull out an example. Let's go to verse 13. Yet the Lord warned Israel and Judah by every prophet. Now notice that. You might want to underline that. Every prophet, every seer. What's he trying to say there? I have given you, and I have given you, and I have given you warning. I've tried every way I can to penetrate your heart. Saying, turn from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes in accordance with all the law that I commanded your fathers and that I sent to you by my servants, the prophets. Verse 14, but they would not listen. Why? Because they were stubborn, as their fathers had been, who did not believe in the Lord their God. And he continues in that same vein, and he gets more into what they did. I do want to go down to verse 16. And they abandoned all the commandments of the Lord their God. They abandoned. Again, it's not God that walked away from them. They left God. If you ever find yourself separated from God, the question we should never ask is, where did God go? The question we should ask, how did I get here? When the prodigal son finally came to his senses, what did he say? I got to go back. I got to go back. I left. If we ever find ourselves in a place in our life when we can't, we no longer feel attached to God and the church, when we know we're not living that way anymore, we need to face ourselves in the mirror and walk back. And
part of that story is the father never went after the son, but he anxiously waited at home. So he never went searching for him. He was certainly ready when that son recognized his departure and turned around and came back. He was ready to party, if you will, and welcome him back. But he didn't go chasing.
And that brings up a great question. Glad you said that. Why did the father never go and chase him down? There's a great parallel here. Old Testament.
I think he knew his heart. The father knew his heart. I mean, there's other
So I want to come back to that. So we can hold. So the prophet with the wife Gomer, who was it? Was Hosea, right? Hosea. So Homer and his wife kind of represent God with his people, and that's kind of the parallel of Hosea, right? And so his wife's a prostitute. He marries her, and what does she do? She returns back to her harlotry, right? To her prostitution. And God says, go back and get her, doesn't he? And he does. He goes back and he gets her. But what does he have to do the whole time with her?
Keep going back to her to bring her back.
He keeps going back and getting her, bringing her back. But did she ever want to come back?
No.
And I believe this is the great lesson here.
He had to tell her one time, say, you got to stay with me. I'm going to be devoted to you. You've got to devote yourself to me.
And I believe this is one of the great lessons of the Old Testament. God is trying to teach us, yes, I could go and I could make you come to me. I could go, I could tie you with a rope and pull you to myself. But what would I do all the time? I had to be worried about you wandering back off. And that's what Israel kept doing. God kept pulling them back. They kept wandering away. Then he'd pull them back. And then they'd wander away. I think God's saying to us, I'm not going to do that anymore. You're going to have to make the choice to come to me. Why does he not go after the son? Because the son had to learn a lesson, didn't he? The father had to become more important to him than his own fleshly desires. Because if the father ran and chased that son down, he'd have to tie him down to keep him. The son had to figure it out on his own. That's free will. That's free will. You know, sometimes I wish God would grab me by the scruff of the collar and pull me in, right? And tie me down. But he says, I'm not going to do that. I didn't do it with Adam and Eve. I left them alone in the garden. I told them what not to do. I left them alone. But they had to make the choice. And that's the way God is with us. We've got to make the choice to follow him. Now, when that son walked down that road, he ran to him, threw his arms around him, hugged him, said, let's have a feast for this young man. Let's give him new clothes. But he had to come down that road. And he had to make that choice. Miss Sandy.
I was going to say there's a worldly saying that even people in the world realize, you know, convincing people, a man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still.
Powerful statement. And very true. It's very, you know, proverbial, right?
So is that God telling us you need to repent and then be baptized?
But it all begins by a decision on your part, on a covenant choice to enter into a covenant with God. He's not going to tie you down. He's just not going to do it. If you want to choose to go and live that life, okay, he loves us enough to give us free will. That also means that on the day of judgment, God is going to sit there with tears in his eyes, I'm convinced. And he's going to watch people be punished that did not choose him. That hurt, that same hurt he felt when Adam and Eve walked out of that garden, were forced out of that garden. Because of their choice. But this time it's going to be eternal. So they were stubborn. They refused to do what God had asked them to do. They abandoned him. And so God gave them up. Who chose captivity? They did. They chose captivity. That is not what God wanted for them. What does Peter say? God is not short, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to each of us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. And so God is long-suffering with us. Thank you, God, for that. All right. Let's go to the end there, 22. The people of Israel walked in all the sins that Jeroboam did. They did not depart from them until the Lord removed Israel out of his sight, as he had spoken by all his servants, the prophets. So Israel was exiled from their own land. to Assyria until this day. And so, in a practical sense, this is at the point, I don't know if I have that map up there. So I'll show you the map here. So in a practical sense, what happens? Well, Assyria invades down into Samaria. They, as I mentioned before, 3 years this took place before they finally captured the capital. Now, it seems to indicate to me that Hoshea had already been imprisoned prior to this, maybe in the very first year. But Israel had continued to try to battle against this inevitability. At the end of that, and probably during that three-year period, Israelites were being captured and taken. They were taken out into the land of Media. Now, again, why does that sound familiar to you? Medo-Persian Empire, who will eventually take the Babylonian Empire over, and they will vastly expand the empire. The Empire of Persia was huge. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But so they took those, they didn't take them all, but many vast amounts of Israelites were taken to other areas. And then what the Assyrians did was they got people from Babylon and some other places, and they then relocated them, because Assyria didn't only take Israel, they also took over Babylon. So they controlled this whole, almost this whole area. And of course, they didn't control Jerusalem, but they tried to take it, and we'll see that later. But they then took these people from these other areas and resettled them into Samaria. Now, this is really important. And get into the next area here, we'll note why. So go on to verse 24. King of Syria brought people from Babylon, Cutha, Ava, Hamath, Sepharvaim, and placed them in the cities of Samaria instead of the people of Israel. So they bring all these foreign people. Now again, anytime the Israelites have had another nation come in, what do they always do? All these nations have what? Their own gods, their own idols. And they bring those with them. And that's what the text goes on to tell us. I won't belabor all of this, but I'll let you go back and read it. But if you read 24 through 41, it tells us how Assyria resettled the land. Now, what is interesting is they came into the land and they resettled it. They brought their gods. And what happened as a result of that? Well, verse 26 says, the nations you carried, this is one of the servants speaking to the king of Assyria. He said, the nations that you have carried away and placed in the cities of Samaria do not know the law of the God of the land. Now, what brought this up to the king's attention? What had God done? Yeah. They developed a serious lion problem. And these lions were causing a lot of devastation. I do find it fascinating. Now Assyria is a polytheistic nation. What's polytheism? Yeah, they don't try to nail down any one god. And they would often let nations keep their god. They didn't have like... They weren't a theistic empire. And so the king, interestingly, he does attribute this lion attack to the Israelite God. Now, he doesn't seem to really know who that is. But what does he decide to do? Well, he says, get one of the priests of the Israelites whom you took out, take him back, and he'll teach all the Samaritans about that God. And that's what ends up happening. And as a result of that, what happens? Well, let's go down to verse 29. verse 28 tells us that the priest was to teach them they should fear the Lord. Verse 29, but every nation still made gods of its own and put them in the shrines of the high places that the Samaritans had made, every nation, the cities in which they lived. The men of Babylon made, and he goes through here and he talks about some of the gods. I won't go through all those. You do note that the Sepharvim, what do their gods command? Here's another one of these evil gods who allow child sacrifice. Just to note, that was not just Baal, right? There were several evil religions like that. So you have all these people, they bring their gods and they bring them into the land. However, it is interesting, verse 32, they also feared the Lord and appointed from among themselves all sorts of people as priests of the high places who sacrificed for them in the shrines of the high places. So they feared the Lord, but also served other gods after the manner of the nations from among whom they had been carried away. And so you really have this mixing, a continual mixing, but even to maybe a greater degree, of these foreign idols and God. And so it becomes a very polytheistic place. Now, why is that important for us to know? Well, as you go on, that continues. You get into the New Testament, and he talks about Samaria. It's not like all that just went away. It's still a very polytheistic place, even in the New Testament. And later on, how did the Jews look at the Samaritans? Well, so let's first say this. Who are the Samaritans when you get to the New Testament? Who are they? And how did they become biracial like that? So all these groups of people that had been brought into the land intermarried with the remaining Israelites, and then they made this kind of melting pot of all these different people with some attachment to God, but also an attachment to their old idolatrous ways. And so when you get into the New Testament, that's one of the challenges that Jesus and the church are going to face in Samaria. So there is some belief in God. And that's why in John 4, she's asking about this mountain. What mountain is she talking about? What? Gerizim, right? Talking about Mount Gerizim, which you could see from Shikar, was one of those idolatrous places that had been set up. And so she's all mixed up about religion. Well, why? The people are all mixed up about religion. They don't really understand it. Just to give a modern example, how much time do I have left? Just to give a modern example. So when people came to America, were they all the same believers? There was a big mix of different religion, even though most would have claimed Christianity. They had all kinds of mixtures of belief. Well, they did too, but they were even in a broader sense idolatrous of all kinds of different gods that they were believers of. And so you really do see that. Let's see. Verse 41, so these nations feared the Lord and also served their carved images. Their children did likewise, and their children's children, as their fathers did, so they do to this day. So at the time of the writing of 2 Kings, that's what's going on there. And so it's a very different world there at the time. Any other questions about that? This is... I know I spent a lot of time on it, but I think this is real important. This will really help you. If you get this, when you get in the New Testament, it'll help explain some things, at least give you a better frame of mind of what's going on as the gospel tries to get into these areas. And think about what the gospel is trying to accomplish. Right? That's the challenge of trying to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to Samaritans. Do you think that might be a little difficult?
Even with us today. I come out of the Methodist, Baptist, Pentecostal, and if I'm not careful, I want music.
Yeah.
I want to bring it in.
Well, that's a great example. And so sometimes when somebody, when we reach the gospel with someone who is of a denominational group who maybe has some ideas that are not scriptural, it takes some time and teaching to help them to understand this, right? We've got to consider where people come from. People aren't automatically, after hearing the gospel, just understand everything in the New Testament. There's some Christians who've been Christians for a while who don't understand all the New Testament. Right.
In some ways, that's how all this got started. I mean, Solomon allowed his wives to bring their idols, and, you know, this makes you happy. Okay, well, that's all I can do this time, or I'll leave this high place over here. It's closer. You don't have to travel 3 hours to Jerusalem. You can just go up to Dan and do your worshiping, or whatever, you know, make it easy for you.
And that brings up two important things for us. That's why we have to continue to teach on all of these topics, because people are still learning. And when new people come in, they've got to learn these things. And also, there is that danger of compromise. And then what happened with the Israelite and the Judite people? Compromise. They didn't have the right to do it. We don't either. But at the same time, we're patient with people. And we try to help them come along to a good understanding as we are still learning and growing. All right. Thank you all so much. You'll be dismissed. We'll get into Hezekiah next week and then Manasseh as we move forward. As you can tell up here, we're getting close to the end.